think it's a hard act to follow, Fred Espinac, who I've known for many, many years, and I was talking about, I really consider him not Mr. Eclipse, but the Dean of Eclipses. And it's even harder to follow ice cream.
So, you've got your community.
Well, I'm waiting for it. And a hot air rise was
good. I don't know.
Anyway, interesting talking about the Teacher-in-Space program. NASA decided to launch me today and take an extra solid rocket booster, but, you know, that's, again, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. So there's an eclipse coming up. And
there is.
You've heard a lot about it. You've heard, again, the Dean of Eclipses, Fred Espinac, talk about it. Today I'll talk a little bit about my experiences and very quickly some ideas for planning. And one thing nice about this eclipse is there's going to be lots and lots of things available. These are some absolutely spectacular, couple for sale out there. Wonderful posters that have been done by Tyler. You can see just this kind of CCC 1930s look we saw with posters for the National Park Service. Absolutely spectacular. So I'm going to talk a little about organizing eclipses, getting yourself ready to go, some do's, some don'ts, that sort of thing. We'll have plenty of time for some questions and a little book signing at the end also. So, you know, there's an eclipse next year, right? This is one of Fred's maps. And it's, again, let me tell you, there's really great materials out there. My grandkids love Fred's wife's book about the eclipse. We have a three-year-old granddaughter. Every time she comes over, she wants me to read it to her. So, you know, let's not miss those opportunities. So, we know about the eclipse. We know where it's going to run. And I want to really talk about my idea of what got me into this. It's going to sound very similar to Fred. And why I keep doing this. I'd seen a partial, the same partial that Fred saw in 1963. And I was very interested in astronomy. So, I had heard about this eclipse that's going to happen on March 7, 1970. And like Fred, I said, well, I'll go see totality. My parents let me drive their Volkswagen Bug up to Waycross, Georgia, where it was decent weather. And I saw 3 minutes and 7 seconds of totality. And I took one decent picture. And I was hooked. I said, this is just incredible. This is something I've got to see another one. And like Fred, I kept on going to these, kept on going to these. And before you know it, you've seen a lot of eclipses. And people often ask you, why do you keep changing eclipses? And all you have to do is see one, you'll understand. So what have I learned after seeing 18 total solar eclipses? Number one, you got to plan. And most of you have started that or have already done it. You know what you're going to do. But this is the word to spread amongst your peers. Plan, plan, plan. You need to be prepared for anything and everything because it will happen. The locals, which we're going to talk a little bit about, these eclipse stories, I'm sure that between Fred Brunches, Fred Espinac, Jim Winter, myself, my wife Debbie, so many of you in this room, we could write a whole book of some of these stories. But Fred's new book, Fred doesn't know this, and Oxford actually asked me to review it for him, and I gave him three thumbs up, even though I only have two thumbs. But they have some of those sorts of stories, but they really make eclipse chasing kind of interesting. Each eclipse is different. And that is so true. We're looking at the corona, the shadow, the colors around the horizon, what planets or stars are visible. All these things make each eclipse very different. And totality goes by very, very fast. And I often wonder if that's just not an proof of Einsteinian relativity. Because I've never seen 3 minutes go so fast as it does during a total solar eclipse. It's absolutely amazing. So I talk about plan, plan, plan. And you know, again, probably most of you have already decided this. Where do you want to observe the eclipse? You need to, if you haven't figured that out, you need to do that very quickly. Do you want a more public site you can share with your best 100,000 planets like Michael Lockage is going to do in St. Joe? Or are you going to go to a friend's home who lives on the eclipse path, just hang out with their friend and drink Corona beer or moonshine or whatever it happens to be? So is it public versus private? Are you going to go with others? Are you going to meet up with others? How's this going to work out? realize it. You know, think through those dynamics. How will you get there? It's just simple things. You know, are you going to take a flight somewhere? So if you have a booked airline, you better think about doing that pretty quickly. Are you going to drive? Take a bus, a train, hitchhike. How are you going to get there? Equipment. You know, immediately when I think equipment, my brain says, okay, what telescope or camera? You know, same thing with most of us in the room. My wife says, what chairs? What cold drinks are you taking? I mean, the sensible stuff. I would be sitting there 2 hours into a partial eclipse of my tongue hanging out, and she's going to be enjoying her cold bottle of water. So don't forget these other things. Prescription meds. I'm so anal. If this comes from running a science museum or being a professor or a Ph.D. or whatever, you know, Paul Tyre, Ph.D. But I have these little graphics that I prepared in Microsoft Excel. Check sheets. I'm sure others of you do too, that I know what I need and what I need to take. And I go right down, like no one's business, make sure I have every filter, every medication, everything I need for that particular eclipse. So don't forget it. What do you want to look at during totality? If this is your first eclipse, take in the entire eclipse. And I want to say something that some of you will disagree with. Don't get stuck behind a camera. Just play automation. Play of ways to do this. Fred does it, Mike does it, Jim does it. There's plenty of ways to do this. You can kind of ignore the camera. But this is your first eclipse. Enjoy the eclipse. That's just my own personal belief. My wife and I have been on 10 eclipses together. And so Debbie has already told me I will not come near any of your cameras. So she goes over, she has a particular pair of binoculars she likes to use. She does her thing, and I kind of do mine, which is okay. So just laying in on this. What do you want to look at there? So you want to look for shadow bands, or the shadows that comes towards you, or what planets and stars you can see. The colors are, I mean, there's so much to see, to take in. Are you going to focus on one thing specifically? And what are your backup plans? Oh, yes. What are your backup plans? I would suggest you have backup groups, especially if weather that's not to your liking sets in. And I would also suggest that you not, unless you absolutely think you can, try to move the day of totality. Don't try to move. I'm just telling you, I think it's going to be gridlock out there. We spoke good news and bad news. Fred Espinette and I were talking, and this could well be the most observed astronomical event or science event in history. And you know what's going to be like on the highways. I had the great fortune of going down to Kennedy Space Center for a lot of shuttle launches. And before that, Apollo and so on. And so, you know, getting to the launch with like Apollo 11, I went down with a friend and his grandfather. You know, a million people were there. A million people. So if you're talking about maybe 50 million for this eclipse, yes, it's all spread out. But still, just have those plans ready to go. All right, so number one, get to the center line. Don't say, well, you know, it's 92% here and that's good. It's not good enough yet. Get to the center line. A partial eclipse can never, never compete with a total solar eclipse, never, ever. And in 2017, there's really, well, there may be some excuses, but there's really, well, maybe some excuses, but I will tell you, if you happen to be caught in this scenario, you need to have your ambulance driver just do a quick drive-by and open up the back door so you can see the reality. Okay? So there's no excuse here. You've got to get to the center line, especially if you've never seen the fall. Actually, you've seen that. 30 of them will do it, Fred, or others. You know, you just got to get there and see this. That's all there is to it. I think I'm preaching to the choir. So, where's the best place to observe a total solar eclipse in 2017? Answer simple. Where it's clear. Everybody keeps on saying, Mike, where's your secret place? Where are you going to go to make sure it's clear? Or are you going to go see the eclipse where it's clear? So that's the best place to see it. And there are. James is wonderful about his prognostications that Fred mentioned also, whether there's, you know, it is a crapshoot. It is kind of gambling, but there's really J's footage to be excellent, that I would be willing to bet a week before totality, before the eclipse, we'll have a pretty good feel what the weather scenario will be set up on. Alright, so moving on here. One of the things to think about is planning out your equipment before you take off. We're not talking about, okay, so I'm leaving on the 16th of August, 2017, so I'll get all my stuff in on the 15th. You should be starting to go through things now. Do you have enough filters? Do you have enough glasses? Do you have enough glasses for you and your friends? Is your outwork that you want to use? You can take binoculars. Do you have filters for your binoculars? Do you want to put them on a tripod? All these things you should be really taking out working through now, not next June, now. And of course, safe observing is going to be a major issue. And I'm sure we're going to hear a lot about eye damage and all that stuff that comes along with it. Remember, safe solar viewing is always a must. Again, I'm preaching to the choir here. You know that. And by the way, this gives a new definition to the term sun dog. You know how you keep a chow who's very, you know, those of you who know about chows, they're very, you know, finicky dogs. I kept this dog quiet for the minute necessary to take his picture with eclipse glasses on. I have no idea. Maybe it's that tranquilized
Benadryl.
So anyway, make sure you get your glasses, your testing your binoculars, your telescope, your camera system. Choose your site, book your hotel. You do realize a lot of hotels are already booked. Booked. And if you wait till last minute, watch those prices. So if you don't have any advanced planning for things like that, you should buy your filters, your glasses. What are you going to use? You're going to have like a solid law mentality out there. So plan in advance. Let's just say you don't book your hotel in advance. Well, guess what? No vacancy. With maybe one exception, Bates Hotel. So where you check in and don't check out. No advance planning for getting to your site in enough time. Making those weather changes, you end up with something like this. I think it's the end of the world, the apocalypse or something. It goes back to the zombies. So the idea is just think it through and get it done. Now, I like eclipse travel, not just for the eclipse. Fred and I will talk about this also. Fred Rutgers and Jim Winter, and I've also talked about this. The people you meet along the way, the places you get to go see. You'll find a lot of people who are wonderful, like-minded eclipse changers, who just understand the love and beauty of the eclipse, the wonders of the chicks. But you'll also have some that, quite frankly, you'll want to tase. Having been a former college dean, I was very disappointed that the administration did not equip me with a taser, because there was a couple students I probably would have you read on the headlines, CNN college dean tases student, but don't tase me, bro. You'll also find some wonderful local people. You know, I think one of the most wonderful things about travel I've had an opportunity to do, like somebody, you know, every continent to see an eclipse, is the fact that there are some really fabulous people out there. Debbie and I were with Fred, and Brunches, and I had to make sure I differentiate between Fred's and Jim Winter, and a little country by the name of Carabas, used to be the Gilbert Islands for the 2010 eclipse. It was an island that had no McDonald's. Imagine! No McDonald's. And the people were just incredible, wonderful. And we went to our little side island for totality. The town elders came out to greet us. And the kids were so excited. It was wonderful. So again, the local people can be a real plus. It's very, very special. And sometimes it isn't as special. Now this was one of those kind of funny things. We had taken a group of about 25 people to the 1991 eclipse in Hawaii, even over to Baja, out from Mexico, California, south of Mexico City. We drove south of Mexico City, had wonderful skies. And we had a lot of local people who saw what we were setting up. They stopped and said, "What is this?" One very nice young Mexican man came over and asked if he could join us. And I said, "Absolutely. We'd love to have you here." And so he was asking questions. And we had our son and daughter, which we take with us to, they're now older with their own kids, to eclipses and to this particular eclipse. And so they were talking about how excited they were as kids to see this. And then the shadow comes over, totalities, diamond ring. It's just like, that's, you know, those who've been there. I don't have words to describe it. This young Mexican man starts yelling, "Holy sheet! Holy sheet! Holy sheet!" That was not a videotape I could play in Sunday school. So that's the holy sheet eclipse. And so there's all these wonderful experiences. This was 2012, after that wonderful southern hemisphere eclipse that ran across Australia and the north and New Zealand. We hit it out of the sea and pulled into New Zealand. There's a woman there, we were at a hotel and buffet dinner. There's a woman there who found out we were astronomers, and she and I were talking. She says, "Oh, do you see the fairies through your telescope?" I thought, you know, gotta be kidding. But being a college professor doesn't surprise me. So I said, "Fairies?" He said, "Oh, yeah, you've got to see fairies when you look through your telescope. Don't you see the fairies?" I said, "Are you from, you know, I think we're in Auckland. Are you from Auckland?" She said, "Yes." I said, "I suggest you talk to your local astronomy club and they'll be glad to show you the fairies through their telescopes." So probably someone is cursing me still as a woman who wanted to see fairies through the telescope. And then, 2010 I think, we went to Easter Island. Great setting, wonderful setting for an eclipse, wonderful skies, but it was the same day as the World Cup Finals, Netherlands versus Spain. And someone had a TV set up and they were watching the World Cup during totality. Now you can put World Cup on replay, you can't put totality on replay. And my favorite story to tell on myself, and we all have these occasional stories. I know Fred Espinet mentioned the 1979 eclipse. I also was in Manitoba, Canada, and had flown out of Tampa where it was 80 degrees and flew to Winnipeg, it was at 30 below zero. And so we decided we really wanted to see the Northern Lights, Aurora Borealis. So a couple nights before the eclipse, we got our rental car and drove north of Winnipeg to have the lights. Off on a striped side of the street, which is up to your nostrils in snow. And so we look up towards the northeastern horizon, and there's these beautiful spikes coming out of the horizon. And so we're taking pictures. Now, this is the old film day. Remember that four-letter word, film? So we're taking pictures of these aurora, and up pulls a Royal Canadian Mounted Police, of course, in a car, not in a horse, but he pulls up, rolls out his window. "What's your boys doing, eh?" "Well, officer, we're astronomers from Florida. We're out observing the Northern Lights." He looks at us, looks at the Northern Lights, looks at us, looks at the Northern Lights, looks at us and says, "Them's not the Northern Lights. Them's are the lights the steel mills of Selkirk." They're probably still talking about us. So I got built steel mill lights in, like a copy. So those things do happen. So, do you want to photograph the eclipse? My question, are you really sure you want to do that? There are people who will take magnificent photos that, quite frankly, you know, you should consider just doing that. So, what type of photography you want to do? Something very simple, something that's much more complex. Again, gotta plan it in advance. Don't decide on August 20th, "Oh, I'd like to do ABC." You can photograph the moon's shadow. There have been some instances, in fact, 1979, I got a wonderful photograph of the shadow, you can clearly see it coming across the sky. The what I call the sunrise sunset effect, the horizon colors. People make wonderful shots. I've seen some of, you've heard of some of Fred's video. I mean, it's wonderful to see these reactions of people. Photographs through the telescope, with a telephoto lens or video. So a variety of great options. But again, don't wait until the last minute. You get wonderful photographs of this kind of combination of people and color, and a few clouds on the horizon. People make wonderful images too. This, my two grandsons at the annular eclipse in 2012. We like dragging our grandkids with us to eclipses. Go figure. And they seem to put up a pop, taking them to eclipse. They really seem to like it. These two will be with us next year also. One of my favorites, we were on a small boat. Fred Brunges will remember this, and so I set a camera. It actually set it on automatic. I didn't even mess with it. So I took this picture. This is the top of the vessel and the eclipse of the sun. It's just a simple photo. And it looks more like a black and white. I had to really mess with the Photoshop to bring up some of the features, but this turned out pretty cool. This one of these I just, put a tripod up and a camera on and said go, and that's what I got. Some people do art. A fellow by the name of Jerry Armstrong, some of you know from Atlanta. He knew I'd gone to Easter Island, so he did this wonderful, wonderful, you don't give me gun, go. My course responsibility after the eclipse. So just fun stuff like that. Partial phase is easy to photograph, easy to show off as you're waiting for the entree to begin. That's the appetizer, but I love the partial. As long as we get to total. Now this is an unusual series of photos. I want to describe what I did here. I like experimenting. I just like doing different weird things. This is November 2012. As I mentioned, this was the cruise we were on. And so what I did is had a really, really high quality Canon 16mm fisheye lens. Really expensive, more than a camera body. And so I wanted to get the sea, the ocean, over the cruise ship, and the eclipse sun in the photograph. Here was the issue. If I oriented it correctly, the normal, what we call portrait, I couldn't get what I really want to photograph. So I said, well, you've got all these experimental photographers, make tilt cameras. So I just said, I'll talk to them. I took a monopod, strapped it to the rail of the ship, put the camera lens on it, set it automatic, set exposure so it would not change. I didn't want automatic, like, as the light decreased, the exposure increased. I want the same exposure throughout. Get planning. And so a team on it is 2 minutes. I went over the camera, said go, then went back to doing what I was doing. And it shot a series of, I got about 400 photographs. Planning again, make sure you've got batteries recharged, plan. Make sure you've got a card that has enough memory on it. Make sure you've got a card in the first place. I mean, these all plain things that make you bring your binoculars, your filters, screwdrivers, tape. I mean, look, even if I'm flying somewhere, I'll bring a little bag of tools and things because someone, usually not me, but someone's going to need it. So these are about 10% of the photos, and I'm going to one of these days get time to sew into a movie, but here we go. So imagine this every 10 seconds, it's the same exposure, and we'll notice the sky starting to darken. Colors around our horizon are starting to pop a little bit into totality. But watch how the sky continues to darken as you become completely engulfed in the moon's shadow. And notice also how the eclipse sun is bobbing up and down because the ship is. And then unfortunately there's certain contacts and out it comes. But just a simple thing to do, but I planned out what I wanted. the CCD. I had someone argue with me saying, "Oh, I'll use my CCD on my telescope in totality." Don't. The field of view is not big enough. Just a simple DSLR. I'll tell you right now, you're going to see people be using smartphones and iPads and all sorts of things to photograph these things. Video cameras. What a great way to put a video camera on a tripod, push go and enjoy the eclipse. Again, you know, there's going to be folks like me and Fred and Jim who, you know, we want to photograph it. You know, that's, we do like doing that. But if you haven't done a lot of this, enjoy the eclipse. So do something like a simple videography. Great video cameras available. Set your camera for the largest image file possible. Some cautions are in planning. Make sure you understand how quickly your camera will remember or record those images. And make sure that you don't use up all the space on your medium. I already mentioned batteries. Yes, I have been in eclipses where people ran their batteries out or ran out of space on their cards, so be careful. And I like shooting at like a very low ASA, like 100, some people go up to 400, just like the richness, the lack of noise at 100 ASA. I know people have different opinions there. And again, that's why I practice. You know, I use the full moon. I'll take my equipment out and practice. I've done this for a gazillion eclipses, and like Fred and Jen haven't published the magazines, have my pictures published. I'll still go out and practice with the same equipment again. Just make sure that everything's okey-dokey. So, practice, plan. Make sure your battery's fully charged. You think I'm kidding, but okay, that's it. Make sure the camera media is in the camera in plain space. Put your camera focused on manual. If you put your camera, you're using a lens, and you put it on autofocus, it will spend the entire eclipse trying to find infinity. And you may get one or two pictures, but you'll be sorely disappointed. I'll talk more about that in a moment. And if you're working on a camera that has a strobe, turn it off. Fred, am I right? People flashing strobes.
Game over.
Oh my God. I have a tape solution, Fred. It's called a hammer. Because if you set off that strobe, you're just likely to have this angry group following you around after totality. Kind of the Frankenstein torches and pitchforks coming after you. Now back to the focus again. Planning. This, you look at these eclipse pictures of some of the state, and one of the reasons they're so good is they're so, how I should say, is anal about focus. It's just important when you take solar pictures or stellar pictures, that focus is just so important. And that's why it's focus, good planning, focus. I did a story for Astronomy Magazine a few years ago about camera focus. And, you know, there's some really well-made lenses today to couple with these DSLRs. And, you know, be honest, I have lenses that cost $4,000. But the interesting thing I found is that focus infinity mark is not always on infinity. When I test out these lenses, what I found is, you know, you look at it, so okay, if I line that focus line up with infinity on my lens, I'm set at infinity. Do not trust that. Plan, check it out in advance, and what I'll usually do is once I find it, I'll put a little bit of tape on the lid to lock it in place. I know some of you are shaking thinking, oh my God, it's going to tape on a $4,000 lens. But it's either that, or what if it slips before you start imaging? So, again, check it out. Usually the full moon. You do my practice runs because about the same, and it gives me just a chance to go through and see that everything works. So just, again, that's how I do it. It doesn't mean it's right or wrong. The main thing is I plan and I do it in advance. Planning, planning, planning. And again, the difference, I have not touched these with any Photoshop at all, but just to give you a feel, these are raw images, or you can just see the difference in exposure length and how much more of the corona you have exposed. And again, I haven't gone in and done any work at all in Photoshop. This next one I have, this was an image that came out as a stunner. This was, again, July 2010, and we were on Easter Island, and I think Spain had just scored a goal, and so the supporters of the Spanish soccer team were all elated, but the Netherlands were not too happy. And third contact, and getting a little bit of hazy, there's a little bit of clouds over the sun, so I was still just snapping away. Well, I went back and started looking at my image and I said, what in the heck? There are lines running through my image. What's this electronic noise? This is supposed to be a really good Canon camera. And there's noise, there's stuff, and jump. Oh, no, they're shadow bands. Some of us got lucky. And actually, there are some visually, the photograph shadow bands racing across the clouds in the sky. All by accident. It was truly one of those, I was in the right place, the right time, pushing the right button, and voila, there you go. So, you know, this kind of relates to this, never give up. No matter what you're trying to do, don't ever, ever give up looking. The reason I mention this, because there's been instances where I was close to being cloud out, or it was about to rain, I still was able to see something, totality. Two I would mention very quickly. One of my favorite stories is December, in fact it's favorite because I saw it, people 5 feet behind me didn't. Jen, Nick Winter, my son Jeremy and I were part of a group that Jen and Nick had led to South Africa for that 2002 eclipse. We were outside of Kruger National Park. And about 30 minutes before second contact, clouds come in. And I thought, well, you know what? I've been pretty fortunate when it comes to eclipses at this time, and maybe this is going to be one of this. So we had already set our cameras. We were actually using drives, all four of us. And shadow comes over. Very dramatic. Even if it's cloudy, the shadow is just makes you want to duck. And so, you know, you kind of run your stopwatch. I'm one of those guys who kind of has to feel how much time's left. And about 30 seconds, I'm looking at my telescope, about 30 seconds before the end of totality, before third contact, out pops the eclipse to sun. So Jen's taking photos, Vic's taking photos, my son Jeremy's doing a video, and I'm taking photos. And so the eclipse is over, and we just look at each other kind of shocked. And so we look around at the people behind us thinking, hey, they're going to be elated. They're all looking at the crowd and mumbling. What the heck? We saw 3 seconds of totality. It's great. So we went to dinner that night. And something I'll say next to my son said, well, I'm really disappointed. And Jeremy said, why are you disappointed? Because we saw something. He said, no, we didn't. It's going to be cloudy. The guy was standing behind my son. So my son, Jeremy, takes out the video camera and says, here's the eclipse. You were standing right behind me. He had stopped looking. Stopped looking. Another one of these examples, don't stop looking, is this photograph. Was actually taken by four people. Fred Brudges, Vic Winter, Jim Winter, and myself. I was in a separate site and was cloudy up to 15 seconds. This was a hybrid eclipse. April 2005. We got, you know, we're talking about very short amounts of totality, over 30 seconds. We got about a minute of clear skies. I took some pictures. Jim processed them into one image showing all aspects, including it's off the screen. just don't give up. Don't quit looking from our side. I love when Microsoft makes those voices. Okay, so. Kind of closure, some wrap up comments before we go to questions. Plan now, if you haven't already. Start planning, getting this stuff together. Where do you want to go? Move the routes in and out. If you have to make up a weather run, make sure you know where you can go. Are you going by yourself, family, friends, astronomy club, outreach? What type of equipment do you want to take? What imaging do you want to do, if any at all? But the one thing I just got to encourage you, and I really have to do this, make sure if this is your first eclipse or your 30th eclipse, and I mean the midst of things, look at the eclipse and experience the eclipse. It's just, again, if you've never, and I know that Fred asked earlier about half of you had not seen the eclipse. Make sure you do that. Because do not get stuck behind your telescope or camera the entire time during totality. You got enough great automated equipment out, you can get out and look around. It's what we call Sperling's Law, which Norm Sperling came up with. It's basically every 30 seconds, take about 7 of those 30 seconds and look around. Look at what you can see. Experience the changes in the weather. Note it mentally, physically. It's really an entire being type of event. And then finally, I'll do like Fred, but wait, there's more.